So I was working on a full Blender beginner course for my patrons recently when I thought, hey, this could be interesting for the scroungers on YouTube too. So here is the full lesson 6, terms and concepts for 3D modeling in Blender from a beginner course where I describe the most important things you encounter in Blender when you start your learning journey. If you're interested in the full course, you can find it on my Patreon page. In Blender, the global space is a coordinate system that defines the position of objects in the 3D world. It is represented by the X, Y, and Z axis. The local space is a coordinate system specific to each object, based on the object's pivot point and orientation. It is also represented by the X, Y, and Z axis, but they are relative to the object's own orientation. When you perform an action on your object, like scaling in the Z axis, you can switch between the global and local space by pressing the hotkey of the axis twice. For example, SZ to scale in the X axis and Z again to switch from global to local space. There is also this drop down here where you can switch it for the whole workspace. The origin is a special point in 3D space that is used as a reference for transformations and other operations. Every object has an origin which is represented by a small orange dot. You can compare the origin with the anchor point in other software. When you move an object, the origin moves with it. But you can move the origin without the geometry to any location in the scene with right-click, set origin, and then whatever you need. Understanding how to utilize the origin will help you immensely while modeling, but also with advanced tools like modifiers. A wrongly placed origin is often the root of many problems you encounter, especially when using modifiers. The 3D cursor is a special point in 3D space that you can move and snap objects to. It is often used as a reference point for adding new objects or for aligning and positioning existing objects. The 3D cursor can be placed with a right click while holding the shift key. You can also snap the 3D cursor to the location of selected objects or to the grid by opening the snap panel with shift S. It is a useful tool for precise placement and alignment of objects in your Blender scenes, and interacts well with the origin of your objects. Let's utilize the 3D cursor in this example to place the center of these four spheres exactly on the edges of the cube. I can go into edit mode of the cube, select the vertex and place the 3D cursor there with Shift S cursor to select it. Back in object mode, I can set the origin of the sphere to 3D cursor and then select geometry to origin. The transform is the combination of location, rotation and scale. Transformations are the modifications you do to the transform of an object in 3D space. An object always has a root transform, which can be changed. For example, when you open the Apply pop-up with Ctrl A, Apply Rotation and Apply Scale functions are used to apply rotations and scales to an object's geometry, rather than its transformation data. This can be useful when you want to permanently change the shape or orientation of an object rather than just adjust its position or orientation relative to the origin. This can be quite difficult to understand for a beginner, but maybe an example will help out. Here is a simple cube. You can see the scale is 1 to 1 to 1. When I stretch it in the z-axis by 2, it is a cube that is stretched in the z-axis by 2. When I apply the scale, the transform becomes 1 again. And it is a simple cube again. When I shrink it in the z-axis by 50%, it is a cube shrinked in the z-axis by 50%. But don't forget, applying the transforms cannot be undone. Ah, and one more thing. Applying the rotation and scale while modeling will fix 90% of your problems. In 3D modeling, the triangle is a polygon with 3 sides and 3 vertices. A quad is a polygon with 4 sides and 4 vertices, and an n-gon is a polygon with any number of sides. It is generally best to use quads as much as possible when modeling because they produce smoother, more even surface topology and offer a good balance of simplicity and flexibility, which is important for a good topology and edge flow. Topology is the way that the vertices, edges, and faces of a 3D mesh are connected to each other. In 3D modeling, good topology is important for a number of reasons, including the ability to smoothly deform the mesh during animation, for better rendering through evenly distributed polygons, and the ability to easily edit the mesh's shape. Edge flow refers to the way that the edges of a mesh flow around the surface of an object. In 3D modeling, good edge flow is important for maintaining a logical and clean topology. There are several factors to consider when creating good topology and edge flow, including the number of polygons used, the arrangement of the polygons, and the placement of edge loops. It is generally a good idea to arrange the polygons in a way that follows the contours of the object. Loop cuts can be used to check if your edge flow is correct. Good topology and edge flow are important for creating high-quality 3D models that are efficient and easy to work with. In 3D modeling, the terms high poly and low poly refer to the number of polygons that are used to construct a 3D model. A high poly model is one that has a large number of polygons and is typically used for detailed and complex shapes. High poly models are often used for rendering and visualization, as they can produce very high quality photorealistic images. However, they can also be more resource intensive and maybe slower to work with, particularly when used in real-time applications such as video games or while animating. A low poly model, on the other hand, is one that has a low number of polygons and is typically used for more simplified shapes. Low poly models are often used in real-time applications such as video games, where performance is a concern. And they are also used for stylized 3D models, where a simplified, blocky look is desired. The choice between high poly and low poly will depend on the specific needs and requirements of your project. Destructive workflow refers to a process in which changes made to an object are permanent and cannot be undone. This means that once you make a change, you cannot go back to the original state of the object without starting over from scratch. On the other hand, a non-destructive workflow refers to a process in which changes can be easily undone or modified. This is often achieved through the use of modifiers, which allow you to make changes to an object without permanently altering the underlying geometry. In general, a non-destructive workflow is preferred in 3D modeling. By using non-destructive tools and techniques, you can create a flexible and adaptable workflow that allows you to easily make changes and experiment with your work. After doing beginner tutorials and finding it easy to copy other tutorials, you will most likely run into the problem of not knowing how to solve a problem on your own. In our case, how to turn an idea you have in your head into a finished 3D model. This requires a lot of practice and the courage to approach and create something without a tutorial. I found a very good comment on Blender Guru's channel from someone who also went through this journey.
To all the beginners who see this, I hope you'll remember my comment. Blender will be tough and frustrating at first. After you complete the series, you will want to create some art, and it will most likely not be very good. That feeling can be incredibly discouraging. It can also feel horrible to not be able to do basic things without Googling the solution, but trust me, it gets so much better. Accept that there is quite a learning curve and you'll be okay. Getting to the point where I could solve problems on my own was one of the most satisfying things I've done. I recommend to watch more tutorials, but make sure to not get stuck on Tutorial Island.
Basically, the process is relatively simple and pretty much always the same, like everything you do in most professions, whether you are an artist or an engineer like me. Every problem can be broken down into small basic blocks. In the case of 3D modeling, you should always start to break down your model into primitive shapes. Once this first step is done, go one step further into the details. This means break down one of these primitive shapes into smaller primitive shapes. If you continue to do so, you solve one little problem at a time. You can make it a rule to always make your mesh twice as fine for the next step. When modifying your mesh, you should always try to think two steps ahead and adjust your actions accordingly. You can get the same result in Blender by countless ways, but only one of them is the most efficient. In the beginning, take your time to always think about the next two steps. It will be slow, but the more and more you do so, the more and more repetition kicks in and everything becomes automated.